Let's talk about concurrency. As I told you in this video,
one of the standout features of this language, and probably the most important one, was its approach to concurrent programming, which I'm not gonna dive into in this video.
Sorry for the sound quality, my old mic. Concurrent codes are hard to analyze and understand, but Golang makes it much easier with its easy and handy syntax. Let's say you are a software engineer in Uber. Well, you have millions of users each day. If you want to handle them one by one by one by one, it would take years. Obviously, it's kind of a long time, so which means that we need concurrent programming. It's really one of Golang's key features. Well, the normal program which we write is like this. It is sequential. First, it defines an object, then it calls this method, then it defines these variables, and then this method, and go on. So on. It means that the computer executes them in an order after each other, only one at a time. There's another way of programming called concurrent programming. Let's see how it is. Before going to it, we have two things. Concurrency. This. And parallelism. They are different, but I don't want to dive into that in this video. Okay, now let's get our hands a little bit dirty. I erase these ones and I clear these out. Okay, let's define a function here which prints 1 to 5 with a message. And we pass that message to it, message which is a string. Now for 0 to, for example, 4, we print the number, the message. And one other thing, I wanted to go to the next line. Okay, and let it sleep. Can it sleep for 500 seconds, nanoseconds, I don't know. We are telling it that do nothing for the next 500 milliseconds, nanoseconds, or whatever. Now we come here, we call it. This is the base form of programming. Sequentially. Now if you want to all this happen in a new goroutine concurrently to this main one, it's very simple. This print here, fmt print line, so we can delete this one. Now if we want to all this happen in a concurrent way, in a concurrent to this method, it's very simple. We just add this term here, go. Now we add this function here, which is the, for example, concurrent to main one. And let's make it actually shorter. Sequentially. Main. Okay. Let's run it. Okay, as you can see, at first we have some sequentially, which is main, and then one concurrent or one other concurrent. And as you can see, they are not, for example, they are not like sequential, concurrent. They are sequential, concurrent, sequential, concurrent. Sequential, concurrent. I mean, it doesn't have a pattern. It doesn't have a single pattern. If we run it once again, now it is different. Sequentially, concurrent, sequentially. It's not close. It's not similar to this one. This is sequentially, concurrent. This is sequentially, concurrent, sequential. Let's picture it in this way. Let's say a startup has two co-founders who do some startup stuff. If we program sequentially, only one of them is working and the other one is getting paid for nothing. It is idle. But if we program concurrently, both of them are now working. And consider that the amount of tasks are still the same in both these cases. The first thing which comes to mind is that it is faster. Okay, come here. Let's get rid of this. Okay, in the first case, in the case of one working co-founder, it's like this. It's timeline for 2 months. something like that. And the second case, in the case of both of them working, we have two timelines and each of them has just 1 month. But in real computers, it's not gonna take 1 month long. They are nanoseconds. Just for getting an intuition about it. Each of these co-founders in Golang are called Goroutines. Okay, so it is faster, it is more efficient. I never understood the exact meaning of the term efficient. I think it's a better use of resources, I'm not sure. But one thing for sure is that now both of our co-founders are working and we have no one idle. So we waste less resources, just in case. Using all of our resources is not good. We'll get back to this later when we're talking about orchestration tools such as Kubernetes. Anyway, so if it's better, why don't we use it all the time? Because it's harder, it's tricky, it's hard to reason and understand, especially at the first glance. Let me show an example, but before that, I really appreciate it if you support my channel. Your support gives me the energy to keep creating contents like this. And yeah. For example, let's get back to our old example, which is this. Let's add some other goroutines. For example, tell this goroutine 0. Goroutine 1 and one other goroutine 2. And let's give this main thread about 100 milliseconds break. So it waits for the result of other goroutines. Let's see the output. Go run. And one more time. Let me bring it here. Okay. As you look at these two orders, you understand that, as I told you, there is no pattern, so they cannot be anticipated. This one is goroutine 021022, and this one is 020112, something like that. And this irregularity increases when we add other goroutines. For example, 3 and 4, and 5 is too much, actually. Let's put it just to 3. Let's clear these out. We run it once, as you can see. One other more. 03402 and 14314. Idea not the same at all. Well, there are of course some skilled programmers out there. There are of course a lot of people who know how to program concurrently. But this type of programming has one other issue too. And that issue is the concept of thread safety. We'll talk about it later. Let's go to Golang's next feature, which is channels. All these goroutines are going to God knows where. So you may ask, what's the point of calling a function in a new goroutine when I can't even get to its results? The answer in Golang is channels. Sometimes some data has to be used by multiple goroutines. Well, each of those goroutines have their own thing to do, but this data is shared. So they should be updated on its change and they should have access to it. Which means that channels should act as a communication mechanism. They should act as a synchronization point. So how does a channel do it? How does it manage data? Does it keep and store data by itself? Well, not exactly. The basic form of channels doesn't hold data. Consider you have a box which you want to give it to your friend. Channels can't act as a shelf where you can put the box so your friend can take it later. Basic form of channels, which are called unbuffered channels, just send data back and forth between some goroutines. Okay, enough talking, let's go to the code. Okay, let's clear all these out. We don't need this anymore. Control S. Close the window. Okay. For using a channel, we should first define it. We name it ch. It is equal to, Golang has a built-in function for defining channels, and that built-in function is called make. So we make a channel of a string. Let's define some operations in other goroutine. Go func, we can define it in this way too. We don't want to give it a name. We don't want to give it an output. Actually, we need something else here. Working with channels are super short and handy. For passing a variable to a channel, we just use this, and this string is a message from goroutine 1. And for reading the data out of it, it's still too short. Let's define a variable called received message, which is equal to this operator of a channel. Now we should print it. Print line receive message. Since channels don't hold data, when the compiler gets here in other goroutine, it gets blocked here. It waits here until someone on the other end of the channel accepts this message. And the same goes for the reader goroutine, which is our main goroutine right now. When the compiler gets here, it waits until the message is sent from this channel. So we have blocks here and here, but we can't see them, of course, because they are like 2 nanoseconds or something like that. Go run. Okay, our main goroutine got the message, actually. Since we are still in the topic of unbuffered channels, let's talk about tokens. Tokens transmit unary variables. Unary means that they have only one possible value, and since they have only one possible value, they doesn't matter to us at all. So what do we care about them? Their existence. The question of when do they return a value? Most of these examples which I've seen was for sending a signal, was for letting other goroutines know what is happening. Let's see an example. Okay, let's clear all this out. For defining a token channel, at first name it tokens to be more clear. And for defining a channel, we should make a channel. Sorry, for defining tokens, we should define a channel with the type struct. Not a string, it's a unary variable, something like that. Now let's define some worker functions. It is called worker. It takes a message as a string, and it takes a tokens channel. Tokens, which is a channel of struct. Okay, now at first it sends a signal to the tokens channel. It wants to announce that it started its working. And the struct, it prints that. Actually, not message is not good. Let it add an index, which is int. Worker I started. We want to pretend that they are working, so we add the time asleep to it. And then we print out worker I finished. And then it takes that signal back from the channel. When we have nothing to do with the output of a channel, we just do it like this. We define a new goroutine. We don't need a name. We don't need an output either. Actually, let's add it here. We define an infinite loop like this. This goroutine is only responsible to take a look at tokens channel to see when does it get empty. So tokens, when this channel gets empty, the compiler runs out of the for loop. Okay, now let's call the workers to start a for loop I from 0 to 3, 3 is fine. And let's run each worker in a new goroutine. We're going to pass it the I and our channel. And let's give a time to the main goroutine so we can, as we can wait to see the results. Time.sleep 500. It's not good actually. Let me put it 2 times. So for 2 seconds. Let's see the result. Okay, our worker 2 started, worker 1 started, worker 0 started. The first one finished, the second one finished, and the 0th one finished You may ask, what does it do? Why did I add this one? The thing is that, as I told you, we are using unbuffered channels, and unbuffered channels get blocked here and here. Consider this situation. Worker number one gets here and it gets blocked. Worker number two gets here and it gets blocked. Worker number three comes, gets here and gets blocked. So after that, all of our three goroutines are blocked and they are doing nothing. So this situation is called deadlock. I don't want to talk about deadlock, but just one thing to know is that we don't want this. It's bad. Prevent that block. There's one other goroutine, which when a signal is passed to here, it gets it, and so the worker doesn't get blocked here, and then it move on with its life to its other businesses. And this was it, guys. No, this wasn't it. Actually, Golang has put a lot of effort on concurrent implementation. It has a lot of features. So I divided the content into multiple videos. Actually, I try to keep my videos short. I think it's more catching. So in the next video, I think I talk about buffer channels, the concept of buffer and mutexes, I think. And it comes next week. No, two next weeks, because next week I'm recording a video about my expenses as a student in Germany and I'm going to Amsterdam. And by the way, my last video, which was about reinforcement learning mathematics, it just doesn't work out. I think no one likes to see such stuff in the YouTube. So that's it. Thank you so much for watching. Be curious and keep learning.